being still, how still is our mind? It has just been weekend, Saturday, and it is still Sunday here. You'll be watching this on Monday. So, Sunday evening, and the weekend is over. Now here, in Thailand, I'm not sure it's a very weekend orientated place. It's weekends are more, well, very possibly because of the people I am mixing with, but weekends, or not mixing with, as the case may be, but weekends tend to be orientated around the Upasatha day, the full moon, half moon, new moon, and half moon each week, which varies. But of course, most countries these days, and indeed, especially in the West, conventionality has drawn through commerce, industry, business together a collective global community of people whom either have the weekend off because they work during the week, or have the weekend as their primary time to work because they work in maybe catering or hospitality. Emergency services, of course, are working 7 days a week. They don't have times. People don't not get ill at the weekend. Emergencies don't cease to happen at the weekend. Maybe, in fact, more so. So, just another convention, but we still call it weekend. I remember a time when I was working, I worked weekends, but it still felt like it was weekend, because people you know, people you associate with, mix with, who maybe not be working, have a change in attitude, a change in maybe a more lightness of mood, maybe a more relaxed approach. Maybe they're less stressed, a bit more carefree, a bit more time for their family. And why is that? Why can it not be like that on Monday morning? I got around that in my working life, in my career, by never working on Mondays. But I don't think everybody can have that opportunity. But I had this kind of thing where I thought, everybody hates Mondays. There was a song about it. I don't like Mondays, back in my time. I think the 80s or 70s, I'm not sure. Based on some tragic story of someone who really didn't like Mondays. And anyway, nevertheless, I was self-employed, and I thought, well, I have to work Saturdays because that's when people have time off and they're able to come and see me, or I was able to deal with their requirements. So I thought, well, okay, if I'm going to work half my Saturday, then I'm having Monday off. And it worked for me very nicely, especially later on when it got towards when I started becoming interested in Buddhism, because I found it was a very useful day for practice, because everybody had gone to work, the weekend was over, nothing to distract me, and I was able to really do nothing, be still, and still the mind. But then we learn through this practice, when we really establish ourselves in the Dharma of practicing sila, moral virtue, keeping some precepts, some basic rules, refraining from killing, stealing, sexual misconduct, lying, and taking intoxicants. And we practice meditation of the sitting and focusing the mind on one thing kind, and also the meditation of mindfulness, of being aware, being able to notice what is really going on. We call it in the Noble Eightfold Path, sati, mindfulness. Now, mindfulness is the common description and is a widely used term in the West now. There are people teaching mindfulness, practicing mindfulness, many books, videos, and all kinds of things on mindfulness. But if you think of that, mindfulness, it is implying that the mind is full. Now, one could say, yes, full of, your attention is fully on what it is you are doing, being aware of. But then that could be also construed as occupying your attention to the detriment of what could be occurring around that subject matter in the background. Is this mindfulness? Is this full awareness? Is this conscious awareness? You really can more apply that to this focused attention of samadhi. So if one has a meditation object of the breath and you're bringing your awareness fully to the breath in sitting meditation, then you would be developing an absorption, an absorbed state of mind on that one mental object in order to be undistracted by thoughts, feelings, sights, sounds, smells, tastes. And this isn't what we need to do to see clearly in real life. Seeing clearly, a word you may have heard, is used from the Pali language vipassana, a kind of meditation practice often referred to develop sati, mindfulness. But what better describes mindfulness really is, let's say the opposite of mindfulness would be mindlessness, mindless or heedless, paying no attention, carelessness. And mindfulness is more applicable to careful. So careful, mindful, and careless, mindless. But now, I'm going to say this word, mind emptiness. I don't like the word emptiness. I'll explain why in a minute. But it is more applicable, mind emptiness, to mindfulness or to sati. Because what mind emptiness implies is a mind that is uncluttered, is clear, and to some extent still, ready to receive through seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, and touching all that goes on, that we are being open with awareness to seeing clearly, vipassana. And this includes thoughts, our thinking. So when a thought arises, an emotion arises, whether it's as a result of a feeling in the body, some pain or some pleasure, whether it's as a result of seeing or hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, you are open to seeing that for what it is, without judgment, without bringing memories of the past to try and bring comparison to this sensual stimulation, sensual contact, without that, and without expectation, without trying to predict the results of that sensual contact, that experience, based on this information you're dragging from the past, which could be incorrect and inapplicable to the moment, there is a tendency to apply judgment and make a prediction and expectation for the future as to what may happen with this contact. Now, mind emptiness is having a clear mind to receive seeing as just that, seeing. Hearing as just that, hearing. Smelling, just that, smelling. And tasting as just that, tasting. Not, oh, I've tasted this before, it's like this. No, It is just that, a taste that is either agreeable, disagreeable, or somewhere neutral in between. And this can be applied to all of those sensory impressions from the five physical senses, and the sixth, sense of thinking, our thoughts and our emotions as they arise. Our thoughts and our emotions will arise and pass away with very little we can do to control that, except to know that. To know thoughts as just that is as close as we can get to controlling, not stopping. We cannot stop thoughts, so don't try and stop thoughts, but stop and be aware of thoughts as they arise. And then you may find you have the opportunity to notice the space between thoughts and where there is no thought, that gap. And this is mind emptiness, as opposed to having a full mind or of mindfulness, or a mind that is careless of mindlessness, so an absence of mind, an absence of awareness. You're establishing a receptive, open, and clear container for all that comes along, where without judgment can be, your experiences can be witnessed and therefore fully experienced for what they are, as just that. And then in this Noble Eightfold Path, or this practice of Buddhism, we are also developing panya, wisdom. And wisdom is really the understanding, the full understanding, that we are, as a result, this human being, the human condition, a result of causes and conditions. So we are conditioned in the sense of our being, in our case, in this species, the human being, we are as much a result of as a result of causes, as are the days of the week, which are just conditioned phenomena caused by man's intervention in order to organize and establish patterns of working time, holiday time, and bringing all society together in terms of a controlled manner. Now, in the ancient Asian calendars, which are still applicable today for many holiday festivals, and you've just had the Waisak, the full moon of May, in some parts of the world, not here in Thailand, it's going to be in early June, the full moon of June, which is when we celebrate one of the main Buddhist festivals, the celebration of the Buddha's awakening, his birth, his awakening, and his death, Parinibbana. When he finally, the physical body gave up, died, and he was free from samsara, had broken all the fetters. He'd already done this in his enlightenment. He'd become what we call an arahant, so someone who is free of greed, hatred, and delusion, free of desire and rebirth. In a future life. So then when his physical body had finally broken down and was unable to be used again, he wasn't to be reborn in the human realm, in the heavenly realms, or the hell realms, or the animal realms, not to be born again into this repeated cycle of rebirth. That's for a whole nother talk, another subject. But where I'm coming to, or was going to, before I went completely off track, I think, was the weekend and our treatment of the weekend and conventionality, and how in working life it was possible for me to find some time to put aside to practice fully this sila, samadhi, and panya, the development of wisdom. And part of this wisdom, or the mainstay of this wisdom, is this understanding in this human realm of what it is that all conditioned things, of which we are one, are impermanent. The Pali word is anicca, so subject to change also, so nothing stays the same. And you know, even the things like the calendar, the days of the week, over hundreds of years and thousands of years, this has changed also. It hasn't always been the Gregorian calendar we use today. In fact, it's still even different in different parts of the world now as we speak. I mean, the year here in Thailand is 2566. It would have been some time ago, now after Vaisak, or in June after Vaisak, that the year would change to 2567. But now in Thailand, I think this is correct, it now would change in January, as do other people's calendar years, to 2567, being that this was this time that the Buddha died, so the Buddhist era. Whereas in the West, we operate on, what is it now, 2023, some 500 odd years after the Buddha's time, became the era of Jesus Christ, the Christian era. So we have CE, BE, Buddhist era, 2566, and CE, Christian era, 2023. So it's 2566 years since the Buddha's time, 2023 years since Jesus's time. And I've mentioned Jesus, so what's going to happen now? This video will be all popular, because whenever you mention Jesus, these videos seem to be considered the most popular video on this channel is well, it's a bowl of food, and then second popular to that is where I talk about the comparisons between Jesus and the Buddha. And there are comparisons to be drawn between all teachers of this nature. And I didn't say anything in that video that I wouldn't repeat, and most comments about that video comparing, not so much comparing Jesus with the Buddha, because there is no comparison, but that the Buddhism, the religion of Buddhism, if you call it a religion, and depending on your definition of the word religion, and bear in mind always that languages are also a conditioned thing. They've come along the cause behind them is the need to communicate in a common manner within society and with our fellow beings. So we have different languages because previously there was no travel when language became a useful thing. Now worldwide there are commonly used languages and less commonly used languages. But essentially, we all speak in language, which also have changed over times. You'll find in the main religions, however, they've used, for instance, in the Christian, in the sort of Anglican or the Catholicism, the Catholic side of Christianity, they use the base language of Latin, because it's a very ancient language, and it has many similarities to the language of Pali, which is the base language for the Theravadan school of Buddhism. And then you have Sanskrit for the Mahayana side of Buddhism, which is also used, I think, in some of the Hindu religions. And then there is Hebrew for the Judaic religions, Jewish faiths, and Greek Orthodox for some of the Greek Orthodox, whatever they are, Christian faiths. These are very ancient languages. And the reason they've stayed in place and are still used in, I've just used in this video, Anicca Dukkha Anatta, Sila Samadhi Panya, these Pali words, is because they have been remained unchanged through causes and conditions over time. So for instance, sati for mindfulness, which can be translated in so many different ways, as already I've just mentioned, two or three different understandings of the word. When you have the feel and the know of the word, sati, it becomes your, like your mother tongue language. You don't translate it other than when you're trying to explain it. You feel it. So I'm sure if a priest or the Pope or someone like this says in nomine Patri et Filii et Spiritus Sanctus, and forgive me if I've pronounced that all wrongly, the Latin of in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, he has no questioning in his mind as to, oh, so he was a father, he was a dad, and then he was a son, and was the Holy Spirit a ghost? Is it Holy Ghost or Spirit? Does that imply spooky? There's no real dilemma, no questioning. It rolls off the tongue, excuse me, as without thinking, from a clear space, a clear mind, a mind of stillness, naturally, having been the result of causes and conditions, but established itself as a language in place to do, perform its function for what it is, without any further discernment. So we have this danger always with interpreting the teachings of the Buddha, or listening to somebody talking about Buddhism or Dharma, where we can pick up on a certain word here or a certain word there, and then debate. Now one must take the wider view as to the subject matter and understand it isn't the word. This is just our way of trying to get a point across, or our way of asking a question. For things to be taught, they have to be passed from one to the other, and there has to be a certain exchange. Now one can take an understanding of what is being taught, or one can pick it apart by the way it's being taught. It is better to take an understanding and only question the your understanding in relation to what is being disseminated, transferred, passed on to you. And this is really what goes on in any conversation. Now in our natural day-to-day conversations, we don't have this problem if we're speaking in our mother tongue to a fellow being. But when we start talking about things of a seemingly high-minded, philosophical nature, you'll see many debates and discussions, and this is the commentaries we have, many books on the original Buddha's teachings from the original scriptures that can fill whole libraries on just that, on really debating the meaning of one word. You can find many, many books on mindfulness. It's one word. One word used conventionally to explain something. And if you see it as just that, a mind that is still and open and clear to see all of its experience, and all of its experience is limited to just what can come through our sense doors of seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting and touching, and what we think. And to some extent we can guard, filter, unwholesome experiences and try and channel more wholesome experiences to develop in turn wholesome mind states and reduce unwholesome mind states. And this is the practice. Now, back to this weekend. This weekend has been all over the world, for many reasons, a busy weekend, I think. We've had Vaisakh in many countries, which can be very busy. It has been that Vaisakh in India. So for Buddhists in India, I mean, it's a Hindu country, but it's also a big religious festival in May for Hindus, I think, also. So I shouldn't say it's a Hindu country. I don't know that for sure. I mean, it's largely Hindu. It's Muslims. There's all religions, Christians. It is an ecumenical country, officially, as is England. Although I say, I think it's largely directly, it's largely Hindu. However, these relations are, sorry, these religions all work in tandem together. And like I was saying, when I was talking about the teachings of the Buddha and Jesus previously, they are, the primary similarity is to treat other people kindly. And through this, you can expect to also be treated kindly back and to do no harm. But of course, Christianity is a theistic religion with a God to be feared. And it's also based on original sin, being born a sinner. Whereas Buddhism is a non-theistic religion. There is no God. And it is based on being born purely, as a pure being. Albeit we may bring with us some future conditions for cause as a result of our past karma, if you choose to believe that karma is transferred from lifetime to lifetime. But there is this choice and flexibility in that the Buddha's teachings are not so bound up by doctrinal and strict rites, rituals and practices to say that you have to believe. There is nothing to be believed. The Buddha taught just what there is there to be experienced. And to be able to experience the advantages that come through meditation, the practice of meditation, based on a sound foundation of moral virtue, then you need this clear mind, this mind of stillness. So, with the busy weekend in parts of the world due to Vaisakh and various religious celebrations, and also in my own country, in UK, in England, I'd say the UK, because it's the United Kingdom that would have been celebrating the coronation of King Charles III, has gone over a good long weekend for those people, taking all of that time off. And then, of course, many, many people working very, very hard for that 4 days, including the king himself and his family and all of the people involved in such an enormous global event as it has been now with media. These things are seen all over the world. And I can't imagine the viewing figures, but I should think they exceed perhaps anything that's previously been shown. I wouldn't know, but I did get to see a little bit of it, the main part of the coronation, out of interest. And what struck me was the whole emphasis on God and the faith behind what I suppose I, after these years of being not so involved in Christianity and in a Christian country, I found it quite interesting to see the whole pomp, circumstance and spectacle of the conferment of power of the I'm being very careful what I say, the establishment, and this is the establishment of the monarchy in its place and what it stands for, and then to see it being carried out obviously in a religious place, a place of worship in Westminster Abbey, and how firmly it is based on God and Jesus and religion in the whole, what's it called? The coronation ceremony. And there's nothing wrong with that. After all, the king of the country, the king is the head of the Church of England, or whom appoints his bishop, his archbishop, or whatever, however it works. So yes, that was interesting a little to me, and it confirms the difference between, well, all religions when you compare them to Buddhism, because Buddhism is in fact the only largely known religion that doesn't have a belief system. Now, that's not to say there aren't belief aspects that can be brought in to Buddhism if you choose to do so, and different beliefs have been picked up as it's transferred, geographically radiated out from its origins in India across the world, taking on different traditions and different mixtures from cultures. And this is part of the faith side of Sada, which is the Pali word for faith, which I tend to believe more as confidence, because faith does imply the theistic understanding of faith in a higher power, or a doctrine, a god, or mystical aspects of religion, whereas confidence is confidence in the teachings of a person, a being, whom taught us how to practice and experience for ourselves the benefits of this practice, and to be free from suffering within this very lifetime, not to believe that after we die we'll, you know, get what we deserve. Now that may be the case, but this cannot be experienced by ourselves here and now. What can be experienced by ourselves here and now within this lifetime is stillness of mind, is freedom from suffering, is confidence in a structured practice, a teaching, the teachings, the Dharma of the Buddha, of how to get there. And this isn't asking anything of anyone other than to try it for themselves. Just that, try it. Try it out. If it doesn't work, well, go back to praying and hoping for something to come along to save you later on. But if it does work, wow, you've not discounted any other or any other people's beliefs. You haven't left. Some messages I get about the Jesus videos are, oh, you need to come back to God, or you will not be saved, and this and that and the other. Well, no, I never left any of these things. I was never really truly there in the first place. I'm not saying I don't believe. I'm not saying I believe. I'm not atheist. I'm not, what's the word? I'm not a believer. I'm not an atheist. Agnostic is somewhere that, you know, I have no view on the subject. How can we know? There's no point me, I don't see the logic in thinking about something that, a question. So I don't see the logic in spending a lifetime on a question that cannot be answered. I prefer to look at the questions that can be answered experientially, in reality, here and now. And if that can be done within a moral framework, without judgment of others, without also breaching any other religion's moral frameworks, which are generally along the same lines of doing no harm, so without transgressing those, I'm also confident, I have faith, that if there is a God, that this God wouldn't be so, or such, as it does say in the Bible, a jealous God, that he would be, right, that's it, and there's no way you're coming into my heaven, or whatever, because you didn't believe in me. Over and above someone who believed fully in him, but went round killing, stealing, lying, taking advantage sexually of people and drinking and taking drugs just because they believe. No, no. I think, you know, this God, if there's a God, is a fair and reasonable entity that would look at people's karma as we understand karma works, in that cause and effect. If you do good to others, you will receive good back. So Buddhism fits in nicely with all religions. And this is why, where it's different in different countries, it's managed to fit in with their old traditions and bring some of those practices in. Some have deities, some have many Buddhas, some are gods, the Buddhas, some, it varies. Some have a lot more ceremonial aspects and rites and rituals, as they can be seen. But in Buddhism, rites and rituals is something, one of the fetters that we drop, the third of the fetters, in order to attain to the first stage of enlightenment, sotapanna. But the dropping of rites and rituals doesn't mean you no longer go to the temple and chant the suttas and pay homage to the Buddha, the Dharma and the Sangha. No. But you go to the temple with the understanding that that is a way of disseminating, of transferring, of expounding upon the teachings of the Buddha in that original Pali language that hasn't changed and is consistent and has maintained the teachings with consistency throughout 2,566 years. Firstly, they weren't written down. They were just passed on verbally through memory, which is why when they were written down, they were written down that way. Much of the chanting is in the form of the way they were written down in the scriptures, in the Pali canon, in the Tripitaka, the actual repetitiveness of the verses throughout the Buddhist teachings is that is a way of transferring information accurately when you don't have reading and writing. And it stayed consistent in that respect. And then after it's been written down, has stayed consistent also. But then on top of this, you have the commentaries, which want to pick it all apart, which is not a bad thing either. It's helping to explain, but you can get a little bit too mixed up from the original point of the teachings and spend a long time on one word or one part of the teachings rather than practicing it holistically in your life for real and for the betterment of this life, to have a better time, be happier, be more content and have a still mind. So here we had a visitor at the weekend, a Kruba Ajahn. So it wasn't anything here. We didn't have the coronation here in Thailand to speak of. We don't have TVs or anything like that in the forest, in the monastery. And it wouldn't be much known about here, apart from outside of or within the expat community. I would imagine they had it on in bars and things. But here, no, it was not something that was mentioned, and it's not Waisak here, so it was a quiet weekend. And I thought, this is nice, a quiet weekend, but everything, I was going to say unexpectedly, but for me, everything is unexpected here because I don't speak Thai, so nobody tells me anything, and that's fine. Maybe if I did, they wouldn't either. But a very senior monk arrived, a Kruba Ajahn, they call these people. These monks that have many vassas and are very well known, very, very renowned in their practice. And you know, there's monks who've been monks for many, many vassas also, who are not well known. And then you hear about monks that you've all heard of. Anyway, a very important, not important's the wrong word, a well-known, well-respected monk came to stay. The first I knew of it was when the abbot called me from my kuti in the morning. I went to help him clean one of the guest kutis over there. So I thought, well, We don't always do this, so this is, must be an important person, a VIP coming to stay. And I looked at my mind and thought, is your mind still? Now, and it wasn't very still. It was thinking, oh, what's happening? I thought it was a quiet weekend, and now something's happening. What is going to be required of me? And then I thought, nothing is required of you. It's not about you. This is your mind. And this is when we have mindfulness, when we have a clarity of mind, and these thoughts arise. And these thoughts can be associated with physical feeling too. You start to maybe feel a little anxious, getting a bit hotter, a bit worked up. And then you start to lose a bit of mindfulness. You know, if people go on a first date perhaps, or they see someone they like, that they have aspirations towards, very often they do silly things. They spill their drink, or they trip over, or, you know, these kind of mistakes, because of the anxiety that's arising in their wanting to impress this person. Now, when one has Kruber or Jans coming to stay, they're probably the nicest, kindest, most wonderful people you can wish to meet. But the fear you have is in how you might do something, or the fear of yourself, not of them, of what you might do wrong. You might break Sila, not so much Sila, so much as any one of those little 227 rules, or just trip up or do something a little bit inappropriate. So you firstly may see this as, oh dear, someone important's coming. But if you have clarity of mind, you can then stop and assess the situation, breathe, and understand that, you know, nothing's changing. Someone very nice, interesting is coming to stay, maybe for a long time, maybe for a short time. It doesn't matter. Nothing changes. You'll still be seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touching, and thinking. And if you have a clear mind, you're practicing mindfulness, you're bringing it now into daily activities. Continue to do your daily activities just as carefully with mindfulness. Not with a mind full of all these things, but with a mind empty, clear of anything. To do everything diligently and as it should be done. Not to be recognized or seen as doing things well, but just to do things as they should be done. And where I say as they should be done, but in the time-honored, practiced way that we were taught as monks in the Sangha, the Buddhist order of monastics, how we do things from the teachings stemming back 2,566 years. So they're very well practiced, established ways of doing things that haven't changed. And mindfulness and the knowledge of those ways of doing things allows us to do things correctly, and also makes things easy. We don't have to think, should I do it this way or that way? Will they prefer it this way or that way? What if he doesn't like this or that? This doesn't matter. The Buddha laid this down. This is partly why we have 227 rules. And in addition to that, there are thousands of other rules. They're not really rules. They're helping guidelines. They're tips. We all watch, or maybe you all watch these videos of how to get through life, tips, tricks, hacks, whatever you call them. The Buddha's teachings are all of that. There are many videos on here using the Buddha's teachings as these tips, and openly saying, you know, what the Buddha said about this and what the Buddha said about that. A lot of it's a bit fictitious, and a lot of it's actually true and absolutely right. But very useful, practical teachings. So after the weekend, we go back to work, and there's or we settle down for a quieter week until next weekend if we have life the other way around. But either way, there can be an experience, a feeling, a notion of change, of something different. And that's all right also, that's okay. But really nothing does change. The Kruber Ajahn has come, the Kruber Ajahn has gone. What has changed? Have I changed? I've aged a little bit, a few more aches and pains than I had the day before, maybe. That's an ongoing process. Living here in the forest at the moment, it's something like, according to my phone, it's always 30 degrees, 33 degrees, something like that. It's been that temperature from, I've been to Nepal, North India, South India. When I was in England, it even said 33 degrees, so I don't think that's terribly accurate. But it says feels like, and today it said it feels like 44 degrees, and actually it really did feel like 44 degrees. So I did feel a bit hot today. It's still hot, but I've got a fan. It's now evening. Fan's more for the mosquitoes, but it's a nice temperature now. Tomorrow will be hot also. But it doesn't matter. 44 degrees, 22 degrees, it doesn't matter. The paths still need to be swept. The kutis need to be the empty kutis, and you need to sweep around those. We're in a forest, the leaves are continually falling. When you finish sweeping, you need to begin sweeping again. You don't, you next time in the morning or tomorrow afternoon, you sweep again. And you build a routine of sweeping to keep the forest where we're living with its paths, which are important to get from one kuti to another, to the temple, to the sala, because there's no, you'll see a little bit of concrete paths around me here, but generally this is just forest and the paths are what we've swept and walked. And those have to be kept clear. The smaller of the two very big snakes has now chosen every morning to be on this little path between where I go from here to get my coffee, our little hot and cold drinks shed. It's Nampana, it's called, which is a little 100 yards or so, 100 meters or so away, 200 meters or so away, by the shortcut. But now I'm having to go a bit of a longer way around because I call it the lady snake. I don't know whether it's the case. There's a very big, big one. Pythons, I think, and also very big, but not as big as the very big one. So the smaller of the two's out every morning. So rather than disturb her, I go a bit of a longer way round. And as soon as the sun comes up, she disappears for the day. But these paths need, imagine if you didn't sweep these paths, you wouldn't know. You know, you could easily tread on the snake, and then this poor snake's going to be in fear of its life and it's going to harm you, without doubt. And you're going to die. So it's important. So whether it's 44 degrees or 30 degrees, it doesn't matter. But if you have a still mind, you just know it's hot, it's just that. And I'm sweating a lot, it's just that. So drink some water to replace the fluids, otherwise you'll get a headache. Obviously we keep our head, we don't wear hats as monks, but we can put our angsa, this under thing vest, we can wrap that like a turban over our head if we're in the sun, if the conditions are suitable for such a move. I certainly do that, otherwise I would suffer from sunstroke. I have a spare bit of actually angsa I've cut up a bit and I do this with to put on my head. And you carry on with your sweeping. And you soon know that it's no different sweeping at 44 degrees than it is at 30 degrees. It's just that, sweeping. So we don't think about this, we get on with this routine. And this helps to keep our mind still. So really try when you're coming into the week from the weekend, or into the weekend from the week, or whichever way your week changes, to go with a flow from one to the other. So the title of the biography of Ajahn Chah, written by Ajahn Jayasaro, which is the most highly, people often ask what books I suggest people read. I think that's a very personal matter of choice for each person, you know, to find the books yourself. I should read in many books I had to read. But one I'd recommend to everybody is this biography of Ajahn Chah, whom I excuse me, so I have to just see what is going on in this tree. Because it's not a dog, because it seems quite high up. Maybe it's a monkey. We don't get many monkeys here. Well, maybe you can see it. I can't. It won't come up. Oh, my! One of my dogs, not my dogs, but the one that lives here is guarding me anyway, just behind me on the steps, so I'm quite safe. Not that I worry. But go from your week or your weekend into the change with a flow. Now, this book I was referring to is called Stillness Flowing, which refers back to one of the teachings of Ajahn Chah. And you think of a stream, a river, and on the surface, to some extent, close up, you see it moving and bubbling about. But from a distance, if you look at a stream, especially if you look at big rivers, even from an aeroplane, they look so still. But of course, underneath the surface, the water is flowing very fast or even slowly. It doesn't matter, it's flowing. So the expression stillness flowing came about. And we must think of this way, not only how to have still minds, but to be stillness flowing. So we're flowing into the new phase of our life, from the week end to the week, and then the weekend again. And this is much the way that we can describe rebirth as being the citta, this awareness, this conscious awareness, flowing. It doesn't die and get reborn, it flows. The body is what dies. The citta has rebirth. But that's a whole other subject. But this principle idea of flowing from one situation to another is what helps us keep sati, or mindfulness, but let's say an empty, clear mind, to experience all experiences for what they are, just that, and not what we are comparing them to. So when you next have a visitor or a new boss, your managing director is visiting your office. I remember that feeling when I had worked, when I did work for a little while for a company, when the big boss came down, apprehension, anxiety, make sure everything's all in its right place, and make sure you're very busy when he gets there. You think about it, you should be sitting there like really chilled out when he gets there, because all the work's been done and you've made him lots of money. But no, you make yourself look very, very busy. But when you come into this monastic life, it's kind of completely the reverse. Everything should be done as it should be, but you shouldn't be busy. You should be mindful, attentive, and caring and careful. And you can still, yes, you can apply this in day-to-day life as lay people, employing this sense of responsibility, but not panic, this sense of confidence that whatever happens, you will experience with the change nothing new, because everything that can happen has happened before. And this way, you can just flow from one moment to the next as just that, another moment flowing into the next. Whether it's Monday or Sunday, Sunday evening or Monday morning, it's just another moment flowing into the next. You breathe in and you breathe out. It is the same Sunday evening when you breathe in, when you breathe out, as Monday morning, as it will be on Friday afternoon when you breathe in and you breathe out, to Friday evening, Saturday morning, and so on. Flow. And you can go with the flow. And life treats you more kindly, because you are treating yourself kindly, stopping and being aware. being still. So I think that's more than enough ramblings for a Monday night for you, for a Sunday evening for me. I shall now investigate what's climbing up the tree behind me. And thank you for watching.